Aliens are out there, dude.
I know they are. I did the math. Maths, ugh. Hey, humans, Trace here for DNews. Finding extraterrestrial beings is not entirely science fiction. It's more like science wait and see, but it's totally gonna happen. It's a mathematical inevitability.
It's true, but there are still some problems. In 1959, the journal Nature published a paper that found that satellite dishes, which are basically electromagnetic wave antennas, have become so sensitive that if pointed in the right place, they might pick up alien communications.
A year later, a Cornell astronomer named Frank Drake did so, kicking off the now famous search for extraterrestrial intelligence, or SETI. Then a year after that, he created something called the Drake equation.
The Drake equation basically breaks down the Milky Way into numbers to arrive at an estimate of how many communicating alien civilizations might be out there. The Drake equation considers the following factors.
The average rate of star formation.
The fraction of those stars with planets.
The average number of potentially habitable planets around those stars.
The fraction of planets which can support life.
The fraction that actually do develop life.
The fraction of those with life that evolved to be intelligent and civilized.
The fraction of civilized intelligent life that have developed communications.
And finally, the length of time it takes those intelligent aliens to transmit signals into space.
And this was all designed to put an estimate on the number of developed intelligent communicative civilizations which are out there waiting for us to find, and they called these N.
But obviously, there are some problems with this formula. It's basically taking a bunch of unknowns and throwing them all into an equation that can give a huge range of possibilities. But even Drake didn't intend for this equation to be a definitive answer as to whether or not aliens with radio dishes are really out there. It's supposed to help us start the conversation about the sheer number of planets which could have life.
Interestingly, as time goes on and advances in astronomy come in thick and fast, we're gradually refining our estimates on how many exoplanets are actually out there in the galaxy.
And there's a lot. NASA's Kepler Space Telescope is even finding worlds orbiting within their stars' habitable zones that are possibly cozy places for life to evolve. The upshot is that the more real data we can throw into this equation, the more compelling it becomes. But there are other factors that the Drake equation doesn't consider, one of them being, how do non-living chemicals turn into living, breathing creatures that eventually go on to build radio transmitters?
Now, there's another equation which uses planetary chemistry to calculate the odds that life could form on a planet at all. It's called the Scharf-Cronin equation.
It's almost like this new Scharf-Cronin equation is one of the missing puzzle pieces in the Drake equation.
The Scharf-Cronin uses the total number of building blocks on a given planet, multiplies that by the fraction of building blocks needed per organism, multiplies that by the availability of those building blocks during the time they exist, and then the probability of the assembly of those blocks in a given time, and then multiplies that by time overall. By building blocks, they mean organic molecules.
From that, it can determine a rough estimate of the odds that an origin of life event would happen on a planet. Turning non-living chemicals into a functioning biology is called abiogenesis, and this new equation provides us with a new microscopic area to study beyond the Drake equation if we're to identify where life could possibly gain a foothold.
Equations like these are starting points for scientists to figure out what we need to know to find answers like, are we alone? Without the Drake and now the Scharf-Cronin equations, we wouldn't have a model to start with in finding out how many planets might have life out there.
This is the bleeding edge of science in some ways. Just a bunch of people sitting around thinking about how we can figure out the answer to the big questions.
So how do we know life exists? Because mathematically speaking, it probably does. Maybe not Drake-level communicative life, perhaps it's microorganisms or plants, but in the end, the 1959 paper by Kekkonen and Morrison put it best in its very last line. The probability of success is difficult to estimate, but if we never search, the chance of success is zero.
One way life could have found its way onto our planet might have been via panspermia.
My gosh, Ian, whatever could that be?
You can watch this video and find out. For argument's sake, let's say life formed on Earth first. In the billions of years of evolution, Earth has been hit by countless massive meteorite strikes. Should these impacts have been powerful enough, chunks of Earth's crust would have been kicked into space. As the planet is covered in life, some of these chunks of Earth rock would have likely had bacteria hitching a ride.
Do you think life exists out there? Tell us about it in the comments. And please subscribe for more DNews. And if you want more space stories from Ian, check out our new website, seeker.com.